Okay, so hi everybody. Welcome to all participants. And before I start, I would like to thank this our colleague, the organizer, for the great organization and give a very successful conference. And thank you, Sergio, for doing part of my job. So I don't have to remind you that you can ask a question on the question and answer box during the talk or raise your question at the end of the talk. So my name is Romain Giraud. I'm a French CNRS researcher in the topological spintronic group at SpinTech Laboratory in Grenoble, and I will chair this morning session. We have three very interesting talks again this morning. Our first speaker is Professor Lorenz Mollenkamp from Würzburg University. You certainly know his seminal paper on the discovery on the quantum spin hole insulators. And today, he will show how to turn these helical spin states in a quantum spin hole insulator into chiral edge states by adding magnetic impurities in 2-6 Mercury Taylor space heterostructures. So, welcome and thank you, Lorenz. Please, you can start sharing your screen and give your presentation.
Thank you, Romain. You were actually in sound a bit slipping for me every now and then, so I hope we can fix this. This should be my screen. Is everybody seeing this? Romain?
Yes.
Yes, okay. So I guess I can more or less start then.
We can see it.
Yep. You also see my laser pointer moving around?
Perfectly moving.
Good. The things I've seen with Zoom, but it seems to be working. Okay, so thanks for the introduction. Yeah, you see from the title of my talk, this is about the Lute magnetic topological insulators. We've been working on this. What I intend to talk about is not ferromagnetic material like the BST. This is because we are collaborating with many of the people here, the TOCHA consortium in matters of VBST. What I'm hinting at here is what happens to mercury telluride when you add magnetic impurities. And mercury telluride is a magnetic, is a 2-6 material. And as you may know, if you add manganese to 2-6s, they don't go ferromagnetic, but you get some peculiar magnetic effects. And those are the effects that we will discuss in this talk here. So it's something else than the stuff we do for TOCHA. My affiliation still is the same. I just can announce that officially today, they finished a new institute here at Würzburg where we'll be moving all our equipment to over the coming months, where we can actually hope to expand and grow our MBE samples in a better clean room environments. Okay, for the talk. This is actually a reminder of where we come from. And this is already what many of you know. This is the paper in 2007 where we saw conductance quantization in mercury telluride quantum wells that had a inverted band structure. You see the quantization here. And this was the cover of Science that actually announced this discovery. And looking at this, I'm still reminded of how difficult it was to convince the designer of this drawing to actually have arrows on these electrons symbolizing the spins. We wanted them to go through the balls, and somehow that never worked out. But this picture we've seen before. A bit of what's behind this, I need to share with you again. So mercury telluride as a material has a inverted band structure. That means that the gamma 6, which usually is the conduction band in zinc blended semiconductors, actually is lowered in energy with respect to the gamma 8, which usually is the heavy hole, light hole valence band doublet. And the reason is not spin orbit coupling. The reason is that mercury is very heavy, and because of this, you get a relativistic effect, simply the relativistic energy correction that lowers the gamma 6 energy to below the gamma 8. And no spin orbit coupling involved because this is an S state. So you have this inverted band structure, which actually means that, as we know now, that you will have a surface state on this material, the topological surface state. If you start adding cadmium, you reduce this relativistic effect. So this barrier material, which we typically use, has a normal band structure, and that means that you have this staggered configuration of the band edges in your material, and that allows you to actually tune the states in your quantum well with the width of your quantum well. And so you have this type 3 quantum well, this staggered quantum well. And now if the quantum well is very wide, the confinement energy is small. And that means that the state that coming from the confinement of your gamma 6 state is in wide quantum well still below the state that comes from your gamma 8 state. And this is the nomenclature we use. And gamma 6 is normally an electron band, so we call this an E state. And this guy is inverted. And then if you add confinement energy simply by squeezing the width of your quantum well, you push the E state above the H state, and you can have a normal band structure. So that's how we first got into these topological two-dimensional materials. Now, of course, this was done in collaboration with the Stanford group, and the Stanford group actually showed how this could work, and they started out with something called the BHZ model, which was the right simplification of the band structure of the mercury telluride to actually show that you can really have a Dirac mass which is goes to zero at this critical thickness, and that you have this inverted situation. So this BHZ model is only a very good approximation of the band structure if you are very close to this inversion point. So here at 7 nanometers, probably still fine. But experimentally, what you prefer to work with is actually quantum wells that are a bit wider, because then you're for certain that you are in the topological regime, to be honest. Now, in these wider quantum wells, there is an extra feature that's totally neglected in the BHZ model, but that we see popping up very, very often in our experiments on these quantum wells, which are these peaks here, which we call camelback, because there's two peaks. They are simply coming from the hybridization. You have band inversion, so you have these two parabola that you actually pull through each other, and at the crossing points, you can have hybridization, and that usually gives you these local peaks, which have a bending in the dispersion. And because of this bending, you get a very large density of states here. This is a Van Hove singularity. And of course, anybody who does experiments with gating of materials knows that a Van Hove singularity does very peculiar things. It will pin your Fermi level when you start gating, and you can get all kinds of extra effects from that. And so this is one of the things that we start to realize is happening in many of our experiments. And sometimes we can use it, sometimes we are a bit upset with it, but it's something that we have to live with. Okay, some other background information for my talk is these two recent studies on lithography. So the original experiments were done in 2007, at the time where we had barely developed nanolithography for mercury telluride. We now know that we've done a lot of things wrong in those days. And one thing is that these samples from those days were made using iron milling, which is very fast and easy to do, but it's also very bad for a very soft material like mercury telluride. With iron milling, you very easily actually eject mercury atoms from your layer, gives you extra doping and all kinds of weird cluster behavior, and a strongly reduced mobility. So you don't want to do that. You really want to go to wet etching, which is a pain, but gives you way better mobilities. I go come to that in a second. And the other thing that I also want to mention is the gate training that we've been using. If you scan your gate voltage up and down for a couple of times, this is a trick we borrowed from ferroelectrics. You actually smoothen the potential landscape in your material, and you get a strongly enhanced mean free path for the conductance quantization. So in these 2007 experiments, we had conductance quantization of something like 2 microns. Right now, we have it over 100 microns, and there's no real limit to it apart from material imperfections. Just a bit more to this. This is the wet etching, which we published now a few years ago. The important data is one of them is this graph. You see that if you decrease device size with the iron milled samples, you see that the mobility that you measure in these samples goes down big time. And again, that is from the etching damage that you get in your sample. And you see this effect more strongly in these small samples. The reason is that while you etch, of course, you have a resist on top of your mesa, which means that the top of the mesa and the bulk of your mesa is protected from the damage by the ions. But at the edges, of course, you will have your ions entering your mesa and destructing locally the material. So that's really where your etch channels are, where you're destructing the material. So it's not a good idea to do that. So what you see is that if you actually don't do ion milling anymore, but go for wet etching. And again, wet etching is painful to make nanostructures, but you really have to do it. You get a way better mobility. And the other thing that gets way better is for example, the Hall and Shubnikov the Haas signals. So these are Hall measurements measured from a small mesa, wet etched, and they look just like the big ones. And these are the Hall data you get from the similar mesa, dry as, and you see it's totally reduced. In retrospect, it was a miracle we could see the conductance quantization in 2007. So here's a picture, a sand picture of these wet edge structures. What you see is that they have very smooth edges now. And the important thing for us also in this sand picture is that we can actually see the material contrast. That the white thing is something that strongly scatters electrons, so that's the mercury. This is the quantum well, which we can see from the side. And we could never see this in iron milled samples simply because of redeposition of the junk that was thrown out of the material by the ions. But you also see here is that in these samples, typically we have way better conductance quantization than we saw previously. So what you see here, this is not on a logarithmic scale, but like we used for the original science paper, this is a linear scale. There's still fluctuations and they have to do with puddle formation in the interior of your material. We're getting a grip on that, and that's what you can see in this next graph. This is this second paper that I wanted to bring to your attention, the gate training paper. These are actually quite big hole bars, as you can see here. These are longitudinal resistance measurements on hole bars, and what we do here is gate training. And what that means is that you start the gate voltage from a certain value, you sweep up a little bit and go down again. And then you sweep a bit further and go down again, sweep still further and go down again. And what you see is that if you do these training events going from in both directions, what you see is that you will find in all of these samples that there is a minimum rho xx in these samples. And actually the smaller samples you can really push to quantization in this way. And the larger samples, at least you go down in rho xx in the right direction for conductance quantization. And this is the graph I already alluded to. Now, depending on the size of your hole bar, with your gate training effect, what you do is basically you reduce the puddles that you have in these narrow gap materials, you reduce them big time, and you can really push the mean free path to something like 100 micron. So these are the tricks we use standardly these days, and they really allow us to get reproducible and reliable results in all types of temperature dependent studies. That was the main issue. So what will I be discussing today? I'll have to talk a little bit about what happens to mercury telluride when you alloy with manganese atoms. And then we start applying what we learn from that. So one thing is that we now have observed conductance quantization in manganese-doped mercury telluride. That was an open discussion in the beginning. Can manganese doping still sustain a quantum spin Hall effect? Manganese breaks time reversal symmetry. So the original ideas were that couldn't happen. Well, we get quantization. And then we show some more experiments on how these edge channels in these materials behave if you apply a magnetic field. So this is kind of a local time reversal symmetry breaking. This is a global time reversal symmetry breaking. And in these emergent effects, we also see the effects of the camelback for the first time. Then I will discuss the high magnetic field behavior, where again, we see very strong effects of ion milling that cause unwanted behavior in some of these quantum wells. And then we see where the time is. I have some more stuff available if necessary. So mercury manganese telluride. Basically, this is what you call a dilute magnetic 2-6 semiconductor. Manganese, you can easily dissolve in 2-6 semiconductor because manganese is a 2 itself. So it will simply add to the band structure in the way that cadmium, for example, adds to the band structure. So you will see that there is some admixture of a heavier atom in the dispersion, but it will simply be a 2-6 band structure, a zinc blended band structure. The manganese does not really do anything else. It doesn't make the material ferromagnetic. It doesn't dope your sample because it's a 2. It has these 5D electrons, but these 5D electrons are sitting very tightly in the shell of your material. They have an exchange with the rest of the band structure, but they don't dope. And that means that they also don't induce ferromagnetism to some RKKY mechanism, like we know from gallium manganese arsenide, for example. Now, you can do this trick for a relatively small percentage of manganese. So what we use here is 1 to 2.5%. You can go higher if you like to, but then you get so much manganese in there that they are seeing each other and they become antiferromagnetically coupled, and that complicates the whole observation. So what we show here is the range where the manganese is typically isolated. And in this range, again, the material is paramagnetic, and so there's zero magnetization in the absence of a magnetic field. But I have this manganese in there, and that, of course, these are loose spins, paramagnetic spins, and that means that now you can also get a magnetization in the material, which comes from these d electrons, which follows simply the Brillouin function for these manganese spins. So the magnetization has this Brillouin behavior, first increasing and then saturating at high magnetic field. And the Brillouin, of course, is for the 5½ spins because you have D5 in your manganese. The G factor sees the same effect. It follows the magnetization, of course. So you get an enhanced, this is called a giant Zeeman splitting with the same Brillouin function. And finally, this is all for 2-6 dilute magnetic semiconductors. Finally, in our quantum wells with manganese, the density after growth are typically of the order of a few times 10 to the 11. The mobility is somewhat worse, we find, than in mercury telluride. So typically something like 200,000, which is still more than good enough to do decent transport experiments. Okay, so what are the questions? Well, I already alluded to some of these. Can we observe quantized conductance when we add magnetic impurities and break local time reversal symmetry? What happens on the edge channels? Do they survive a global change in time reversal symmetry? And what does this Van Hove singularity do? So I'll be talking here about three devices. And there's an overview here of the actual band structure in these devices. And so this is a diagram showing how this transition between trivial insulator and topological insulator works if you add manganese. And this is very similar to what would happen if you add cadmium, say. So already showed in one of the first slides that, of course, a narrow quantum well is a trivial insulator where you have the E1 state above the H1. And for wide quantum wells, you have the inverted situation. So these are all topological materials. Now the manganese concentration will influence this region where the material becomes topological. And the other thing is that the width of the quantum weld and the amount of manganese also determine how strongly this camelback that I already alluded to start to dominate your whole dispersion. So we work with three devices, and they are in the limit where you have a direct TI and an indirect TI, as shown here. And what I mean with the direct TI is that while you do have this camelback, it's quite presently there, but you still have an extra peak at the gamma point. And so this gap at this point here is smaller than the gap, the indirect gap between the camelback here. So this is what we mean by a direct topological insulator. But if you go further out or add more manganese, if you go further out, what you will get is situations where actually you have no peak at the gamma point anymore in your dispersion, or have a very small peak sometimes there, and you have an indirect gap dominating your material. So we'll be looking at all of these types of situations. So the first question that we wanted to ask is, what do these magnetic impurities do to destroy the quantum Hall effect? And there have been a couple of predictions in the past about what can happen. And of course, what you're worried about is that the magnetic impurities will cause a spin flip. So a spin in your S channel will scatter off this magnetic impurity. You get a spin flip. And because of that, you get backscattering and your quantum spin Hall effect is gone. Now, there are extreme theoretical ideas about how bad this effect could be. There was this paper by Tanaka et al. Who said actually there's virtually no effect. And the idea here is that well, yes, you can have a spin flip occurring once on a certain magnetic impurity, but it can only occur once. And once the spin is flipped, it cannot flip back. And because of that, if you do a steady state experiment, there is no real effect on the conductivity. The other extreme is by Altschuler, who actually allows a relaxation of the spin of your impurities. And if you then have strong interaction, Altschuler predicted that there's Anderson localization. Now, before these two extremes, there was another paper by Josef Matsaiko and Sucheng Zheng, the group we collaborated with, actually saying, well, the effect need not be that strong. What you can get is condo singlet formation in your edge channels. And if you have that at the lowest possible temperatures, actually there should be no effect. But yeah, at somewhat higher temperatures, if there's enough relaxation of your manganese spins, you should see a suppression of the conductance. So that's what we set out to see. And here you already see the result of the experiment. This is a small device, wet etched. And we had to do gate training to really get a decent quantization. But what you see here is very clearly a conductance quantization in these samples. And I should add, you can tell, at least I can tell from the the very detailed structure here, that this is a millikelvin experiment. This is 20 millikelvin, 30 millikelvin, something like that. And we see conductance quantization here. We also see the fluctuations are pretty reproducible. So you train once or twice. And after training, the fluctuations are reproducible. And you see the conductance quantization both in conductance and in resistance, of course. So what you also see is that the plateau is very long, at least this is for our taste very long. It's 0.3 volts in gate voltage. It's way longer than in samples without manganese. And this has to do with the camelback that actually is eating up a lot of the charge that you put into the sample. So we get conductance quantization. How does it go as a function of temperature? Well, that's in this graph here. Which is the temperature behavior of the gate scan through the gap. So one thing you see is that if you go to higher temperatures, you very rapidly see that the length of the plateau is reducing big time. And again, I'll show in a second, that has to do with the fact that the camelback is playing a major role in carriers, in trapping carriers in your material. The other thing is that the conductance quantization I showed you actually is only good at these really 20 millikelvin like temperatures. If you go to somewhat higher temperatures, you see that actually the conductance is reduced. So this looks like backscattering. So this already starts to look like this model where Kondo singlet formation actually recuperates the conductance quantization might have something to it. So a bit more detail first on the length of the plateau. This is a calculation we've done on the density of states in these materials. And what you see is that with the density of states we get from a simple K dot P calculation, if you assume that the carriers in the camel's back are basically localized, and the mass is enormous, so they are basically localized at these millikelvin temperatures. We also have independent evidence of that, and that they can be released also into the conduction band by slightly higher the temperature. You predict already from this theory and simple Boltzmann modeling that you indeed get an enormous decrease of the width of your plateau as a function of temperature. And so that's basically explaining what we see here in the width of the plateau. It also means that if you want to really characterize the conductance in the plateau, of course, you should limit yourself to the region here where you are in the plateau region and not in the region where you have thermal activation. So that's what we're doing. And so this is the region where we actually confine ourselves to when we plot this average conductance that we measure through the gap. You see the same data here again. What I can add now is that we can compare this experimental data that we have with a theory of the Zhang group from 2009. And basically they indicated that if the interaction between your impurity and your edge channels is not too strong, they predicted that you would get Kondo singlet formation at the lowest possible temperatures, which would lead to a recuperation of the conductance quantization. If you have too strong an interaction, then they also predicted that you would get localization. So this goes down the conductance if you come from low temperature. Then you will approach the Kondo temperature where you can have this correlated effect. And above the Kondo temperature, you should slowly be increasing in conductance again towards conductance quantization as the Kondo effect goes away. Now, this latter effect we cannot see simply because at these temperatures above 10 Kelvin, we have across the gap excitation. So we cannot really see the recuperation anymore, but we do observe a very clear Kondo temperature. And from fitting our data, the red line really is a fit to our data using the theory here, the theoretical expression of Batseiko. We can really fit our data nicely with a Kondo temperature of something like 4 Kelvin and an interaction parameter of 0.5. And the nice thing is that this parameter of 0.5 is also what you get if you evaluate this expression with some typical parameters describing the behavior of the material. So it really looks as if this first theoretical prediction on Kondo effects really was spot on in predicting how manganese impurities will affect the quantum spin Hall effect. So that was local time reversal symmetry breaking. What will a magnetic field do? Let's have a look. This is the same sample. And now we measure both rho xx and rxx and rxy in this sample as a function of perpendicular magnetic field. And what you see is that, well, you get some fluctuations. This is a very small sample, and so you can get some ballistic stuff going around the edges of your sample. But the overall picture actually is really clear. So you come from conductance quantization at zero magnetic field. Rho xx goes to zero at finite B fields, already pretty low B fields. And at the same B fields, and that, which is about, well, 0.2 Tesla here, you see the development of a quantum Hall minus one plateau in rho xy. So that's what's happening. So somehow something is happening to these states. These are, is a very low field, of course, for quantum Hall quantization. And of course, the suspicion directly is that this may have something to do with these quantum spin Hall edge channels. To study this in more detail, we actually went to larger samples. But the physics is all very much the same. So this is a big Hall bar, macroscopic Hall bar, with slightly different band structure. It's one of these devices that I showed in the first dispersion plot. So what you see here is for V gate is zero. This is rho xx as a function of gate. So this is in the middle of the gap for this big material. You see the same effects. Rho xx goes to zero, and we have a minus one quantum Hall plateau in this sample at something like 85 millitesla. Now, I should add that this is a big sample, so it's too big for us to see conductance quantization at zero magnetic field. That we only see then normally in something like, well, factor of five smaller than this one. But the effect is clear again. We see this minus one plateau at a very low perpendicular magnetic field. Now, we kind of had expected to see something like this, and that is because of another very early prediction that I'll show in a second on the quantum anomalous Hall effect. To show a bit more how we can squeeze this minus one plateau onset, if you play a bit with gate voltage, and you saw the gates can, so if you just vary your gate voltage slightly, you go to the valence band, you see that we can actually have this minus one plateau starting at low as fields as low as 50 millitesla. So that's basically almost zero field, which of course is interesting for certain applications. Now, the reason we kind of expected this thing to happen is a paper, again, from Su Chiang's group from 2008, where they actually, this was the first prediction of the quantum anomalous Hall effect. The idea was, well, we cannot get any quantum anomalous Hall effect at zero field in mercury manganese telluride because it's not a ferromagnet. But if you look at a band inversion in your material, so you have the H1 state above the E1 state, and you now start applying a magnetic field, of course you get spin splitting, and the G factor for these two H and E1 states have opposite sides. And that means that actually, if you apply this perpendicular magnetic field and you have this large G factor of the order of 20, what you will get at a given moment is that the band inversion for one spin direction gets undone. And for the other one, you get a even larger inversion. And that would mean that yes, for this one spin direction, this spin up direction, you don't see an edge channel anymore. And you're left with a single, which now a chiral edge channel for the spin down state in this case. So this was the original prediction for the quantum anomalous Hall effect at the time. We did not know anything about chromium or vanadium doping in BST. But this is actually what we hope to see. And we had, of course, already at that time seen low field quantum Hall effects in mercury manganese telluride and mercury telluride. So we thought this might have to do with it. But the problem is, if you really work out the details, you just don't get things to fit very nicely. So what you need in terms of fields to get this situation happening is something like half a Tesla to actually get this crossing going. Now, what we observe in our samples is the crossing somewhere occurring at well, 0.05 or 0.1 Tesla, which is a way smaller magnetization than what we estimated we would need to get the quantum anomalous Hall effect. So basically, we see our quantum Hall plateau at lower fields than what we expected for the quantum anomalous Hall effect. And that's where we figured, well, we should, the mechanism is not quite the same thing as what Chao-Ching Liu predicted. So we had to look at our K.P. band search here again. So here you see actually what's really happening. So what you have here, this is a K.P calculation done by Wouter Beugeling and our group on a strip. So where we get, so this is a lattice model, a finite lattice on a finite strip, where we both get the bulk band structure and the edge channels in our material. And what you see here in a color code is the location of the various states that we have in our sample. And so you can see that the red and the blue states are the edge channels on either side of the sample. And that's the other observation is that you see many of these states here in a conduction band. That is because that's a finite size effect. We cannot really make these samples in our calculations small enough not to see the lateral quantization. But anyway, this is the zero field situation. And at zero field in the band structure that we have in our material now, the Dirac point is just above the Camel's back. And actually this is a anti-crossing in our calculation, again, because of the finite size effect we have in these calculations. But what happens in this calculation to this band crossing at finite perpendicular fields is the important thing. What you see is that actually the spin states that you have degenerate here, actually one of the spin states, of course, has to go up with magnetic field and the other one has to go down. And what happens is that both of these spin states are actually leaving the gap. But the important thing is that there's one spin state that actually shifts down into there towards the valence band. And there it sees an enormous density of states because of the presence of this Camel back here. So what you will have here is that this single spin channel hybridizes away, while the other spin channel actually moves up and it kind of gets into the conduction band, but the density of states is still very low there. So that means that spin state is still existing. And so this is kind of the mechanism. We lose one of the spin states, but already at way lower magnetic field due to hybridization with the Camel back in the valence band. And that's giving us this very low quantum Hall plateau. Now, what happens at gate voltages a bit more into the valence band than what I just showed? What I just showed was all with the gate voltage really in the gap of the material. If you go to slightly larger gate voltages, I'll show you in a second what that looks like, you no longer see a direct transition to an n equals minus one quantum Hall plateau. What instead you see is a series of states, actually a whole series of quantum Hall states going from five to minus one. And it depends on gate voltages a little bit, but you see that we have Hall quantization that feels actually as low as 20 millitesla now, but this is then a couple of chiral edge channels. So what's happening here is that we are actually with the gate voltage now in the range, hitting the valence band. And of course, where you hit the valence band, you also hit the Camel's back in these samples. That means you don't really move your Fermi level anymore. But this sample is a type one sample. And that means what I'm doing now when I add gate voltage is I add more and more of these localized holes in my my Camel back, but I'm not doing very much to the density of states in the gamma point, which has a much lower mass. So what I get is these guys here in the Camel's back, they kind of screen away all kinds of imperfections, and I have a very low density holes in my at the gamma point, which can make up my quantum Hall effect. that's correct is something you can see here, which actually is this measurement of the Hall voltage for these various gate voltages at still lower fields. So what you can get from this is the density that gives you the p-type quantum Hall effect. And you see the density is very low. And at the same time, we know from measurements in the N regime that the gate efficiency should give you way larger densities, two orders of magnitude larger densities than what you get from the Hall effect. So all of these carriers that you put on your gate are basically stuck in the camel's back and are actively screening away all kinds of impurities that the potential might impose on these few carriers in the gamma point. And that gives rise to a very high mobility for these holes. At least this is something we found very impressive in this material here. At these low densities, we have mobilities up to 1 million for holes in our material. And those very mobile holes at the gamma point are, of course, giving us the quantum Hall effect. Now, already alluded that this might be interesting. And so one of the things that's ongoing in the literature is this thing about flying Majoranas, mobile Majoranas, and how you could do quantum computing with them. There have been reports on actually contacting these Majorana modes with a superconductor in a BST quantum anomalous Hall structure. Some other people, myself included, actually disagree with that observation. So we had another paper in Science. Actually, the observation in the first paper has changed data axis. And what we can show is that actually in this vanadium doped BST compound and in the gradium chromium doped BST compound, you do not induce superconductivity in quantum Hall edge channels. Basically, you're just splitting up your sample. So everybody is still looking for superconductivity in quantum Hall edge channels. And we think that the system that we have here might be an excellent one to do just that. Okay, so now we have this very early N minus one plateau. What would happen now if we increase the field? Typically what you expect is nothing will happen. So you will simply follow the minus one plateau up to very high fields, and then perhaps at some field you get magnetic freeze out. But to be honest, we have not been able to reach this freeze out in any decent sample yet. So nothing should happen. But what does happen is the following. Very surprising. At zero gate voltage here, this is the same wafer that I just showed the N equal one plateau. You see that occurring here. You go to fields above something like 5 Tesla. And what you see is that the plateau actually is left behind in RXY. Well, you get a kind of a shaky curve. Again, this is not noise. This is really what a sample gives you. It's fluctuating the resistance, but it's reproducible. And it's going up very slowly and reaching an N equal one plateau. Now that's weird. At the same time, if you look at the same sample, you can also look at RoXX. What you see is that in this transition, during this transition, you see a conductance quantization at 2E squared over H. Now that reminds you of these helical edge channels that we have in the quantum spin Hall effect. And actually that reminiscence is even stronger if you now vary the gate voltage a little bit. What you see for different gate voltages is that you can influence the magnetic field when you transition between minus one and plus one. But for all of these cases, you see a longitudinal conductance of 2E squared over H. So that could be a single chiral edge channel going somewhere. It also could be counter-propagating edge channels like in the quantum spin Hall effect.
Lorenz, can you please take 5 minutes more?
Sure.
Thank you.
So if you then take the same sample. So I was just indicating we might have a chiral edge channel. We might also have helical edge channels. What you can do is a non-local measurement on the same sample, where you now push the current between 1 and 6. and look at the non-local signals here, this one, 4.5 and 3.5. What you see is that also these guys are quantized. Somewhere 1/3 e squared over h over e squared and 1/6 h over e squared. Now, these signals we can also understand from a Landauer-Bütike picture if we have edge channels in there, but only if we have counterpropagating helical edge channels in this sample at these fields here. So what's going on there? How can we have a minus one and a plus one like response at the same time from our edge channels? That there's something weird is also very apparent from the experimental Venn diagram that you can make from your quantum Hall data. What you see here is the experimental Venn diagram, which simply is the voltage derivative of the Hall conductivity. And what you should see is all Landau levels, and you see this works nicely for the conduction band. But in the valence band, again, here we directly go from minus one to plus one. And this is really different from what happens in a theoretical calculation of the bond structure you should do. And so what you really should get is a transition between minus one and zero and plus one. What you do see from the theoretical calculation is that, hey, this transition occurs more or less at these fields here, where this star is, and these fields are actually where the zero Landau levels are. There's one for spin up coming from the conduction band, one for spin down coming from the valence band in these materials, and they cross at a finite field. This is also something we knew for a while. They cross at a finite field, and there the sample is no longer topological. So somehow, this transition between minus one and plus one happens at fields where exactly the sample becomes no longer topological. It becomes trivial, field induced. So that, and combining this information with what we knew about dry etching and damaging the sample at the edges of the sample, actually gave us a model that we now think is going on in these samples. So if you have extra damage, you get puddles at the edges of your material. So your Landau level or the potential profile seen by the carriers in the sample should look something like this here and not like flat Landau levels that you have in an ideal calculation. So you get preferential damage at the edges of your sample. So now we can build a story, and that is what we think is happening. So at very low fields, we have this topological minus one edge channel, which still exists in our sample because the sample is topological, and we described how this comes about. But we have strong puddles at the edges of the sample because of the damage due to the dry etching. Now, at this field where actually we get a crossing of these two zero Landau levels, the topological edge channel will disappear. But what you can have now is kind of a percolating, still p-type, but now counter-propagating edge channel along the insides of these puddles. And this one, because it goes in the opposite direction of the edge channels of after that the edge channel that we had previously, looks as if you see a plus one quantum Hall state. So this means that this sample only sees the minus one to plus one transition due to fabrication damage. And of course, the way we know now to get around this fabrication damage is simply to use wet etching. And that's what we do in the next slide. And here you see this experiment.
Lawrence, sorry to interrupt you. Could you please go to the conclusion soon?
This is the one but last slide, please, Roman.
Oh, very good.
What you see here is what happens if you compare dry edge samples and wet edge samples. And what you see in the dry edge samples is what I just showed you. You go directly in your sigma xy from minus one to plus one. But if you wet edge the same material, you see, if my laser pointer is behaving, you see now simply a zero plateau for the fields where you actually expect to see a zero plateau. So the minus one to plus one transition is kind of an artifact simply due to the iron milling that you do to your sample. And this explains some kind of worrying observations that our Stanford colleagues reported in 2015, that they also saw no edge channel. And there were some suggestions that the edge channels that we had in our material were trivial and not of topological origin. So we now know that our Stanford friends actually fried the samples, over-edged, and actually caused the observation of these puddle-induced situations. So I don't want to slow this here. I will go to the final slide. Basically, what I've showed you is the effects of manganese and some other etching peculiarities on the transport in our materials. So we see a condo screening-induced quantum spin Hall effect at very small fields. We see that the edge channels will survive magnetic fields simply because they are allowed to hybridize with bulk states and turn from helical into chiral edge channels. And because of that, we see very low field quantum Hall effects. And we understand finally the minus one to plus one transition as due to fabrication damage. There's more effects of manganese in mercury telluride, but that's only in 3D bulk materials, and that's for next year's talk. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Laurens, for this very interesting talk. Now the session is open for discussion. So I think you can better hear me now.
Yep.
But I have lost now the video, but it's okay. So we have two questions on the chat. If you can hear me, then I will read. The first one is from Vahid Sasgari. He's asking, is this gate training needed because of the gate electrode-dielectric interface state or capture charges?
Well, a bit of both. What we think is that, what we need to use in these materials is a gate dielectric, because you cannot really gate the two sixes with a Schottky. So these oxides, of course, are never perfectly fitting to the lattice, so you will have local imperfections. So you get indeed imperfections at the interface that you can screen away. But I think the major effect is not so much the interface in our case. The major effect simply is that we are in a narrow gap material. Puddle formation is something that happens in all narrow gap materials. If you locally have some doping, the material very easily gets locally N-type, locally P-type, and that's basically what's going on. And what you do with the training, of course, is you flush some carriers in and out of these puddles, and somehow the potential smoothens up a little bit.
If I may just add to this question, so it means this gate training, you do the same for independent of the manganese content?
Yes, you can do it for all types of samples, yes. Now I should add it, yeah, so we do it for, so what I first showed is that we first found this in non-manganese containing materials, but it also works in manganese containing materials.
We have a second question from Ramesh Tamankar. He's asking, how do you make sure that these samples are absolutely clean? I understand that you grow this in UHV, but still, I would guess that there are defects, process induced. Do these defects affect your measurements?
Yeah, well, this is a peculiarity of mercury telluride. So we do MBE growth, and MBE is more than CVD, I would say that. Typically, mercury telluride does not want to be doped. And many of these materials that you grow in MBE have a preferential doping. And also many of these topological materials, they all want to be either N or P-type. Mercury telluride, and this is for chemical reasons, is the only exception to the rule. It does not want to be doped. So that means I don't have any impurities in there because they're simply grown out of the material. So there are basically very few defects in these materials. There are growth defects. That's what we get. We get dislocations. It's mainly because the substrates are not as good as what you can get from gallium arsenide. And these defects, in the end, the growth defects, will limit our mobility. So what we see In our samples, if we're lucky, we can get up to 2-3 million mobility, but more typical, the quantum wells without manganese have something like 400,000 mobility.
Okay, thank you. We have a third question from Yong Ha. I couldn't see the full name, but for this participant asking, it seems that for wet edge sample, the minus one channel happens at higher B than for dry edge sample. Why? Why is the plus one channel at high B noisy?
So the last one is easier to answer because this is a percolation phenomenon. Huh? So really, this other edge channel has to percolate along the inner edge of the damage that is occurred by the dry etching. So this is a process that actually relies on interference, constructive and destructive interference along this rough edge, and that gives you these fluctuations. It's not noise, it's quantum interference. If it happens at higher field, I have not noticed it. Let me have a look at the picture. I don't really see it. Romain is typing an answer.
Sorry, I'm trying to see if there are some more questions. So I'm just checking the chat. yes, so apparently there are no more questions. Maybe if I can ask one or two more.
Sure, go ahead. There's Juan Sierra raising a hand, I noticed.
Oh, okay. So,
yes, yeah, can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. Thanks, Lawrence, for the very nice talk. So Juan Sierra from ICN2 Barcelona. So I have a curiosity. So the emergence of these quantum Hall states at low magnetic fields. So you apply the magnetic field out of plane, so perpendicular. So I'm wondering what's happened when you tilt the magnetic field. Can you?
You can get some effects, and this really has to do whether you want to look at orbital or Zeeman effects. I mean, that's actually in the paper that I quoted. So we have a full set of data with in-plane fields, and it allows you to actually determine what G factor is important, the orbital one, so the Zeeman one,
okay,
or the orbital one, and that's all consistent with the way that we do our KDLP calculations.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
Okay, so we have another question from Carmen Gomez. Can you please unmute the microphone, thanks.
Okay. Hello, can you hear me?
Yep, now I can, yeah.
Yeah, thank you for your talk, it was very nice. I wanted to ask you, how do you measure the manganese concentration on your MB heterostructures?
that's a good question. Well, we measure flux in our MBE, mm-hmm. and B, you can measure magnetization in a thicker wafer for calibration purposes. You can do Raman,
okay,
and you can do infrared luminescence.
Okay,
out of that you work out a calibration curve. So it's kind of painful, but you can do it.
Yeah, and how do you measure your fluxes on the MB? Do you have a crystal quartz, or do you have?
Yeah, this is a quartz. This is a quartz cell.
Okay, thank you very much. Yep. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you. So apparently there are no more questions. So maybe I have a very short last one. So you're showing a strategy to start from the quantum spin hole states. Usually they have a rather small gap. And then of course the Zeeman with the giant Zeeman effect, then you can inverse this spin polarized gap for only one state. The question is, if we would consider system with a larger quantum spin hole gap, would this still work? Because in principle, I need a really giant, or you would need a much larger field simply to reach the same state.
You would probably have if the inversion at a quantum spin hall, if that's what you mean by gap, if that's larger, then of course you need a larger field. Yeah. So here, you're kind of helped if you want to see the effect at low fields by having a small inversion. So you could tweak for it, but of course the issue is always tweaking these quantum wells is hit and miss, to be honest. You can aim for 7 nanometers and you will get 7.0 plus or minus 0.5 nanometers, something like that.
Okay, thank you. So apparently I missed another raised hand. So Ivan, can ask his question, please.
Hi, thank you very much for the talk. I have a question about the part of this state that you generate in the edge due to the dry etching. So I wonder if I was just looking at the slides that you present to us, and I wonder if you can get rid of them if you play with the baguette. I mean,
not enough. Basically, what happens is, so these puddles, we know a bit more about them. So what happens with dry etching is that you kick out mercury out of your material. And locally, and a mercury vacancy actually acts as a acceptor. So what really happens is that you locally create a lot of holes at the edges. And we have not been able to actually get rid of only those by any gating action. Backgating is another issue in these materials. There is not so much backgating possible unless you grow on gallium arsenide. But if you grow on gallium arsenide, the substrates that we can get for these materials are cadmium telluride, and we cannot get them doped. So if you want to backgate, you have to grow on gallium arsenide. It gives you a big lattice mismatch, which gives you imperfections and also stuff that screens away your backgate. So there is some backgating, but it's not that great.
Okay. Thank you very much.
So thank you very much again, Lorenz, for all these very nice, interesting results in the discussion. I think we should move on to the next speaker.
Okay. Thank you. Bye-bye.